There was a study in 2016 where scientists reported that 1 trillion species are estimated to be on Earth currently, with only 1,000th of 1% described. There's an article in the New York Times that claimed that the world holds 300 pounds of insects for every pound of humans. Imagine if insects, in their vast volumes, different kinds of insects on Earth, imagine if they were as smart as even a cat, or, God forbid, a person.
We would be fucked.
We would be fucked, yes!
People say that we have explored more of the moon than we have of the ocean floor. Like, we know more about the surface of the moon than we do about the floor of the ocean.
Like the bird, insects are also suffering from human activity, and a 2020 study by Science Magazine suggested that population of insects are decreasing rapidly, about 9% less insects per decade. The Earth is large enough for all to share, but mankind's heart is not large enough to care. That is a quote from A.D. Williams. What do you think, Ellen?
Bars. Absolute heat.
We'll talk more about that in a moment. But first, let me introduce the listeners to episode number 269 of Tennis Podcast. If you're a Tennis Pod Plus member, you're listening to me now early and ad-free. But either way, we're here now, and with me is my fellow animal lover and human, Ellen Weatherford from the Just the Zoo of Us podcast.
Thank you so much for that kind introduction. I'm so excited to be talking to you here again, Nick.
Again. I know. Well, I was just telling Ellen before we hit record here that, yes, listeners, she's been on the show before. It was way back on episode 179. We did the top 10 most beloved or popular or charismatic animals on Earth. Ellen brought me that list. And it's been too long. That was like 2 years ago now. Can you believe that?
It does not feel like that at all.
No.
But now you got me back for episode 269. It's too nice. You got me back for the too nice episode.
This is exactly 90 episodes later from the last time you were here.
So now I'm in a rhythm.
Yeah, so every 90 episodes, we'll have Ellen back for the rest of her life.
Now there's a pattern we've established.
Yeah. But Ellen, as you know, on your show, you review animals, and we're going to review all kinds of animals today. I'll give you a chance to plug your show here in a little bit. But any animal lovers out there, you need to listen to Just the Zoo of Us. And today we're going to talk about the quote I said at the beginning. Let me read it again. The Earth is large enough for all to share, but mankind's heart is not large enough to care. What does that quote mean to you, Ellen?
I'm hearing that the Earth has provided abundant resources and enough for every species on the Earth to thrive, but the human species particularly is overextending and consuming more resources than can be spread to the rest of the species on the planet. So I'm getting a conservation crisis angle.
That was beautifully said. Wow.
We talk about this a lot.
I know you do. It was very well said. And we are going to be talking a little bit about conservation today, but mostly we're actually talking about the exact opposite. We're talking about the animals that overpopulate the Earth.
Wow.
Yeah. So, and I know the quote was a little misleading, and I apologize. I just thought it was a great quote. But as you talk on your show, I've mentioned here before, on the episode you were on, we talked about it. Humans are the most destructive animal to the planet, by far. But several animals are thriving, despite that. Humans among them. And so we're going to talk about the animals that are the most populous on Earth. So the top 10 animals that there are the most of.
This is very exciting. I am so glad you're bringing me this, because this is something people like ask me a lot, and I never have a straightforward answer. So I'm very excited about this.
Yeah, I think this is super fascinating stuff. The bulk of my list today comes from worldatlas.com, but I did pull some stats and trivia from Live Science, National Geographic, and of course, our friends at Wikipedia. Ellen, let me read you this little intro real quick. This comes from World Atlas. More than 99% of all species, which amounts to over 5 billion species, that ever lived on Earth are estimated to be extinct. 99% of all animals ever are extinct. Estimates on the number of Earth's current species range from 10 to 14 million, of which about 1.2 million have been documented. And there's at least 86% of those that have not yet been described. Now, those figures and percentages might differ a little bit depending on your source, but I think that's roughly in line. There was a study in 2016 where scientists reported that 1 trillion species are estimated to be on Earth currently, with only 1/1,000th of 1% described. So there's a huge chasm between the first stat and second stat I read. The truth is, we don't really know how many species are currently on Earth. All we can do is estimate. There's a lot of them, though. There's a lot of species. Can we agree on that? Yes.
I've had a lot of guests on our show who actually got to name some previously undiscovered species. Like, they got to be the ones to, like, document them and, like, give them the scientific name and stuff. That's always very exciting.
The great thing about so many creatures on Earth is your podcast will literally never run out of topics. Like you could do an episode a day for the next 1,000 years and you'd still have enough animals.
Sometimes we'll be like, well, what are you going to do when you run out? And I'm like, there are 30,000 species of ants. Like, just of ants.
I know.
And it would be here a while.
You might tuck that little factoid away for later. But let's talk about the list itself, what you're guessing. So the web of life on Earth is teeming with a myriad of creatures, each playing its own role in the grand narrative of nature. Counting populations of certain animals can feel akin to a Herculean task because a massive number of species, like reptiles, insects, and birds, and rodents, are elusive, highly mobile, or have habitats that make accurate census taking challenging. So, another variable that complicates the calculations is the fact that wild and domesticated animals have distinct differences. For example, rabbits. Wild and domestic rabbits are abundant. The domestic population is around 709 million, while wild rabbits are difficult to count, could easily be in the hundreds of millions. I say all this to kind of set the table that it's really hard to get an accurate count for any specific animal, but we're doing our best.
These are kind of vibe-based numbers.
Yes, they're estimates, and some of those estimates vary greatly. So I'm just trying to set the table. I do have to tell you a pretty big caveat here, that this study from World Atlas said there's not enough data on reptiles, mice, rabbits, or rats. So those animals are excluded from the list.
And I think that's fine, because I think if you're going off of sheer numbers of individuals, I don't particularly think any of those animals would be even in the top 10. Like, I don't think they would be.
I think rats might.
I could see rats, because they do tend to live in high densities. Like, they're very social, so you'll see, like, tons of them all together in one place. But, like, lizards, for example, and I'm from Florida, like, I know what a lot of lizards look like. It's not going to be in the density that you'd see rats in. Like, rats I could see being in high enough density to, like, maybe crack, like, that upper echelon of population. But, you know, as far as, like, rabbits and things like that, I don't think they have the... I don't think they've got what it takes.
You don't think the rabbits have what it takes to crack this elusive top 10 list? Wow. Shots fired. Sorry to all the rats out there.
Sorry to the rabbits listening.
We got a lot of them. But I want you to know those animals aren't on here, so don't even try to guess it. And one other thing is bacteria. Is bacteria an animal?
No.
You know the answer? I know the answer. But okay, so no, you're right. Bacterias are not considered animals. I had to look that up because I actually wasn't positive. But for those wondering, there are 39 trillion bacterial cells in the human body alone.
I don't love that.
39 trillion just in your body, Ellen.
I'm going to just go ahead and let that one float right back out the other ear.
You're not going to hang on to that one in the long-term memory?
Not processing that information at all. That one is not getting uploaded.
Okay. Well, I'm glad to hear that. So now we're ready to guess the top 10 animals ranked by population. Number one is the most populous. Number 10 is whatever. You get it. Number one's number one.
Okay, so I have to try to guess which one is the most populous animal in the world. I'm going to talk you through a little bit my thought process here with my guess. I'm looking at the ocean. Most of the Earth is ocean. Most of the life on Earth, life originated in the ocean. Like, most of what you're going to see is in the ocean. So I'm looking at the ocean. I'm thinking about something microscopic, because I'm thinking about plankton. I'm thinking about, like, little tiny little creatures that are going to be floating through the water column, the things that get sucked up by whales and things. Now, plankton isn't, like, a species. Like, something called plankton. Like, plankton is what you call just all the tiny little microscopic animals floating in the water. So this could be fish larvae, it could be copepods, it could be little shrimp and krill and stuff like that. Like, all that is called plankton. Plankton is not, like, a species.
Which of those animals within plankton that you just named own the chum bucket?
That, so plankton from SpongeBob is a copepod. He is based on a copepod, marine biologist. And so, like, you get all those cool, like, marine biology in SpongeBob. So Plankton was a copepod. Now, so I'm thinking it's going to be one of these little microscopic guys that's going to have the title of, like, most populous. I'm going to say copepods. I'll say some kind of copepod.
Now, your logic is sound. And
excellent.
It makes,
I'll take that.
Well, hang on.
A win is a win.
This is a bit of a win and a loss because your logic is sound. It's hard for me to argue it. However, it's not on this top 10 list. It seems like it should be, but it's not.
How granular are we getting? Are we getting down to the species level, or are we kind of like...
We are in... So I'll tell you an animal that's not in the top 10. It's number 12, and that's cats, which includes domestic cats, big cats, all cats are included in that.
And, okay, so we're taking a pretty zoomed out sort of view,
yes,
of things. All right, then I feel
and
okay saying copepods then.
Yeah, I'll bet. So I have the top 15 in front of me. I'm only going to make you guess the top 10, but cats is number 12. And for context, it has 600 million estimated in the world.
That's so many.
And you got to think, it doesn't say, but I'm guessing like 98% of that is the domestic cat, because almost every big cat is like on the endangered list. So that's number 12 at 600 million. Now, number one, I'm not going to tell you number one's number because it's going to give it away, but I'll tell you number two has 3.5 trillion individuals on the planet.
This sounds like a familiar number. I'm trying to reach into the recesses of my mind. Is it a chicken?
No chickens. And well, chickens, the broader, what's a step back from chicken?
Like, birds.
Zoom out.
Fowl.
Yes.
Or birds.
We'll go with birds. Birds is on here. Where do you think it ranks? It's not the 3.5 trillion, I said.
Wow. I'm going to put them a little lower than that then. I'm going to put them at maybe about six.
I think you should have gone even a little, when you said a little lower, just a little bit, because they're not number two, they're number three.
Oh, okay.
Number three.
I should have taken into consideration that I just said birds with, or I just said chickens with, like, there's a more than anyone could ever count of those.
No. There's, I think I remember hearing actually that there's as many chickens as people. I think there's roughly the same, if I'm not mistaken. Now, but if you can count all birds, which includes everything, every flying mammal, well, they're not mammals, but every flying animal, that's also not true because insects fly and shit. You get what I mean. Birds. Everyone knows what a bird is, okay? They got feathers and wings and beaks. They're number three, 50 billion estimated population, which means for every one human, there's about six, a little over six of this animal for every one human.
So look around. Look for your 6-to-1 ratio. Do you see the six birds? If you don't see one, you're the bird.
Helen, you just blew my mind. I always felt like there was something off about me. And now I understand I might be a bird.
Yeah, I mean, you ever feel like your sort of nose is just a little too, like, hard and pointy? And, like, it just feels a little too, like...
No, less the nose, more so just I only eat things that have been regurgitated into my mouth from another bird. So I guess that... Maybe I should have figured this out sooner.
Yeah, that's an important part of it.
Well, the bird, Ellen, it's number three. Since birds are highly visible and common animals, humans have had a relationship with them since the dawn of man. And based on fossil and biological evidence, most scientists accept that birds are a specialized subgroup of theropod dinosaurs.
Mm-hmm.
And I've heard that, like, the closest relative to the T-Rex is the chicken, which is a wild thought.
How much of a tangent do you want on that?
Oh, let's go 10%.
How much do you want about this? Okay, we'll 10%. Do a 10%. There are no living descendants of T-Rex. So, like, all birds would be equally related to T-Rex. Like, you could say, like, hummingbirds, penguins, like, any kind of bird equally related to T-Rex, but, like, they are still theropod dinosaurs. Just descended from a different theropod dinosaur, not T-Rex. T-Rex died off. Had no descendants. But, like, you could say that for any bird, and I still feel like it's fun to say a chicken, because a chicken is, like, kind of the silliest to be like,
well, I think that's,
it's a little,
yeah,
T-Rex.
I think that's the spirit of it. Man, I wonder what, so that was the 10% tangent. I wonder what the 100 would have been. You're just, like,
wild,
screaming, and, like, your face is bright red, and you're, like, cussing out at, like,
I have strong feelings and opinions.
Okay, so fuck, alright. Sorry,
no.
The chicken and the T-Rex are not the same.
I get so excited, like, when this comes up, because I'm like, I knew this one.
Yeah. Well, I remember the first time I heard, like, as a child, the first time I heard that, like, birds are basically dinosaurs or descended from dinosaurs. And That's such a wild fact, because dinosaurs, as we understood them when I was a kid in the 90s, like, you picture the Jurassic Park version of dinosaurs, and now more research has come out, and we think that a lot of them had feathers, like the T-Rex might have been a feathered dinosaur. It's just, it's all very interesting and evolving science.
Have you seen Prehistoric Planet?
I think I have. It's like a documentary on Netflix.
It was on Apple TV when I watched it. I don't know where it is now, but they have feathered dinosaurs on there, and that makes me really happy. I think it's great. I think they look awesome.
I think most modern depictions of dinosaurs, like at least in documentaries and stuff, are feathered. Like, I think Jurassic Park feels stuck with it because of the original movies, that they don't, like, they can't add feathers to the T-Rex in the fifth movie, right? I'd be upset by that, in fact.
I think people are coming to terms with, like, realizing that, like, when you do include the feathers, there's more aesthetic directions you can go in there. Because then you can give them different colors and markings. You can, like, take cues from modern birds and, like, give the dinosaurs the same kind of, like, vibrant colors. And, like, you can make them look visually interesting. Whereas, like, I feel like without the feathers, it's kind of like, yeah, I've seen this. You're like, you've seen one, you've seen them all. Sort of like, yeah, I get it. This is what a dinosaur looks like. But once you add the feathers and, like, the soft tissue structures and stuff, you're like, now we're cooking.
Yeah. So what I'm hearing is, Ellen, if you were to visit Jurassic Park as it's depicted in the movie Jurassic Park, you'd look around at all these amazing creatures from... that have been extinct, and you'd look around and be like, eh, no big deal. I've seen the T-Rex. I don't need to see any of these other ones. No big deal.
You do like the quick sort of like walk in for like 5 minutes, and you're like, I think we're good. I think we're done here. I get it. I get the gist of it.
Man, Ellen is so stuck up when it comes to dinosaurs, I've learned. But let me tell you about not dinosaurs, but birds. So birds, like I said, they figured throughout human culture. And at the top of this episode, I had the quote about how humans suck and they're killing all the animals. Well, they estimate that about 120 to 130 bird species have actually become extinct just since the 17th century due to human activity, and hundreds of more birds before that as well. And human activity threatens about 1,200 bird species with extinction today.
So as kind of like a sort of sub, like underneath human activity, also humans introduce cats to areas, and cats have been responsible for like mass bird extinctions, like introducing cats into like North America and stuff where they're not native, and they just, you know, like cats will kill for fun, like they kill birds just for funsies.
To me. My cat just yesterday is like the world's cutest little cat. Like, he's just gentle creature, loves to be held, and he's friendly. His name's Napoleon, and he was outside and he had murdered a baby mouse. And he was just carrying it around. I mean, it's not a bird. I know we're talking about birds, but he killed this baby mouse and was just carrying it around and just like laying next to its dead body. And I'm like, bro, you're well fed. But I know it's like a sport.
They do it for fun. That, like, human activity also, like, introducing like non-native species into areas has caused a lot of birds to go extinct too.
Yeah.
Funny cats. Not going amazing instinct for birds.
No, but luckily, there's a whole hell of a lot of them. I mean, they're number three on this list, so they got a few to spare.
Isn't that crazy that they survived, like, the Chicxulub asteroid? Like, they survived, like, an entire apocalyptic asteroid strike and then an impact winter for, like, millions of years, and they made it through all of that, and now this is what's doing them in? Like, it has to be a disappointment.
The household cat. Yeah. It's funny how it works that... Also, on the cat side, like, you take the cat, you domesticate it over thousands of years, but you're never going to get rid of that core instinct that it wants to kill this flying creature that it sees.
That's my job. That's what I do.
Yeah. It's just part of their DNA. It's interesting. Well, yeah, so that's the bird at number three, and there's a lot of them, about 50 billion. So what else do you think is on this list?
Okay, now that I kind of have an idea for the scale that we're looking at and like how zoomed out and zoomed in we're going, I'm going to say beetles. I think beetles are on here.
You have to go even further out than that.
Oh, insects?
Zoomed out. I mean, insects are on here. Now, if there's 50 billion birds, where do you think insects are?
They got to be one or two. I'm going to say one. I'm going to say number one.
Okay. Insects are number one. I'm curious what you think could even compete with the insect for number one. There's 10 quintillion insects estimated. I don't know how they fucking estimate that, by the way.
Every time I hear the word insects. Quintillion, immediately I'm like, this is some little kid on the playground making some up. Like,
know,
infinity
right?
times it's quintillion. Like
10 quintillion. Infinity beats all. Yeah. 10 quintillion. Now, what does that mean? That means that for every one human being, there is 1.4 billion insects per human.
So I'm imagining just 1.4 billion insects all swarmed together in a trench coat.
Right. Yeah, I wonder how many insects it would take to, like, equal the mass of a human. You know what I mean?
An amount I'm uncomfortable with.
Yeah. Well, I actually have a related note I'll get to in a minute. But first, what are insects? They're the most diverse group of animals. They have more than 1 million described species, and they represent more than half of all animal species. The United States alone hosts a staggering 91,000 species of insects. Now, this is where we get into the mass thing I was just talking about. There's an article in the New York Times that claimed that the world holds 300 pounds of insects for every pound of humans. So that means that with an estimated 20 quadrillion ants, so we're just talking ants now, 20 quadrillion ants, their biomass of ants comes to 12 megatons of dry carbon, which is more than all wild birds and non-human mammals combined. And I have one more stat on this note. Insects are... Actually, that's a separate thing. So let's pause there. So there are 300 pounds of insects for every 1 pound of humans on Earth.
I love that. That is a... Because there's so little that, like, it takes so many of them to make up just, like, a small amount, and even in a perceptible amount of weight.
Think about ants. Think about your typical ant. I mean, how big is your typical ant? Like, just teeny tiny little thing, right?
Wouldn't even notice it.
And... You take all the ants in the world, and they have more mass than every mammal and bird in the world combined.
It makes me wonder, like, because, you know, when you look at something like an anthill or something like that, most of, like, what's going on is below the surface. So it makes you just think about how, like, there's this entire population of the world that we just can't see, like, that they've got their own goings-on that we just don't know anything about.
No, they have their, well, I know you know this, they have, like, their own social structures, and they have a class system, and they have a queen. Oh, interesting. It's like,
it's amazing.
I mean, like, you have elephants and lions and giraffes, and then you have this little tiny ant.
And each ant is so dumb. Each ant is so stupid. Yes. Like, an individual ant has nothing going on up here. No, zero no. thoughts. Purely, like, programming, right? Like, the ant is just, like, programmed to execute certain functions when it, like, encounters a certain stimulus. But when you get them all together by the thousands, they have, like, infrastructure and air conditioning. And, like they do these incredible feats of, like, civil engineering with just each little one. Is just, it got no brain, it got no, I mean, they have, like, something like a nervous system, but, like, they have no thoughts.
No, well, first of all, I just want to apologize to all the ants listening and remind you that the thoughts expressed by Ellen are not the thoughts expressed and opinions shared by Tennis Podcast.
If an ant is listening to this alone, we're set. They have no idea what we're talking about. If, like, 20,000 ants are listening to this together, we're in trouble.
I love that. Yeah, God, you're so right, though. It's just so fascinating.
No, I guess it makes sense that there would have to be, like, the most of them, because it takes so many of them to, like, execute a task.
Yes, I think just ants, and ants are one of a million described species. Ants alone would be number one on this list, much less every other insect you can think of.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, there's probably a bunch of them, like, in my room right now that I probably just don't even know anything about.
You know, I wonder what it's like, because imagine if ants or any insect, because I think what would you say is the smartest insect? You might not know, but, like,
the smartest insect, I would give individual that insect. To the smartest individual insect, I would probably give that to maybe a dragonfly.
Okay,
dragonflies
sure.
are really good. They're really smart, I think.
Well, they're relatively smart, let's be clear. Because even the world's smartest dragonfly is nothing compared to what? Even, like, you know, a cat or something like that. So, maybe you'll correct me, but I'm
cats are murking them at every opportunity. They're like, oh, they're like a cat is like an anti-aircraft missile. They're just anything flying in
they're
the vicinity.
Like, King Kong hanging on the Empire State Building, swatting at everything that comes by, like the planes. But the point I was getting at there is, like, imagine if insects in their vast volumes of different kinds of insects on Earth. Imagine if they were as smart as even a cat, or, God forbid, a person.
We would be fucked.
We would be fucked. Yes. Because even though they're small, if they're smart as humans, all they gotta do is start figuring out, okay, we all gotta come together. And different species of insects. Now you're having the ants teaming up with the spiders and shit. And I know a spider's not an insect, don't come at me. But like, they're, you know, a spider's not an insect, right?
No, no, arachnids.
They're, okay, they're separate. Yeah.
Close. Okay. So, I will grant you, call them bugs. I don't care. Call whatever bugs. You want a bug. Yes. Who cares?
And look, I'm sorry. I don't know how you're going to feel about this, Ellen, but if I see a spider, motherfucker's getting stomped. Sorry.
Like, I can't boss you around on that.
Some people get really upset at me about that. One of my frequent guests, Stephen Clark, who's on this show a lot, he likes to stand up for the spider and say, relocate the spider outside. And you know what? Stephen, you are clear to do that, but if that motherfucker is seen in my house, its ass is getting stomped to death. Sorry.
I am a spider advocate, so like I would promote like safely relocating the spider, but also like I get it. I'm like, you know, I'm not going to hate on you for it. I don't care.
I appreciate it. This is a hill I'm willing to die on, so I will not pin on this one. Anyway, I don't know where I was going with all that, but if insects were smart, we'd be fucked. We're happy that they're not smart.
Yeah, we would absolutely be boned. That would not be good for anybody, and because they would also probably be really mad at us, and so they would be out for blood at that point. They would have vengeance on the brain. That would
people
be like test
me,
number one.
Who just talked about stomping them. Like,
yeah,
if they're listening
like,
to this,
that guy first.
I would be fucked because I live in like kind of a wooded area. The insects would just like rise up like in a horror movie and just all march toward the house. And I'll bet you if you get enough insects together, they can like break through your windows and open your doors and it'd be trouble.
See, I feel like I have, having done the podcast, I've done very many pro insect and like advocating for support the insects. We've done sort of like mosquito apologism, you know, like I think I have enough of a backlog of like insect allyship that when the uprising comes, I think I'm good. I think I'm safe. Maybe they'll like spare me and maybe keep me around for some sort of like utility purpose. Like maybe they can find a job for me. Thumbs. I got thumbs. So maybe
I'm
going to
clip the audio of you saying, ants are so dumb. And then I'm just going to send that with no context.
Hopefully the good outweighs the bad here. I think I've earned some social credit with the ants.
You got more credit than I do. I know that. Well, last thing on insects is that, like the bird, insects are also suffering from human activity. And a 2020 study by Science Magazine suggested that the population of insects are decreasing rapidly, about 9% less insects per decade.
Oh, it's called an insect apocalypse, I think they're calling it. Is the insect apocalypse? There's like a huge collapse of insect populations, especially because of the use of like pesticides for agriculture. Huge. And then pesticides have like a cascading ecological
effect.
They
have a negative effect, yes.
All up the food chain. So like you end up losing birds too, right? Like because the birds eat the bugs and then bigger birds eat the smaller birds and then you end up kind of having this like population collapse because of pesticides. So
yeah, they're not good, but I don't know what the answer is because I got to keep these bugs out of my house, Ellen. What do I do?
Yeah, I certainly, you know, we still have our, I mean, we rent our house, so like our landlord pays for pest control and stuff like that. So, you know, I certainly don't understand the infrastructure of pest control and agriculture enough to have any, you know, sort of action points.
What the hell are you doing here? You offer me nothing here. So far, I've gotten is that ants are dumb, that chickens are not T-Rexes, and now you have no information to give me on agriculture and the pesticide industry.
I know. How dare I? I have, unfortunately, I'm woefully, I'm only bringing L's to this episode.
Ellen with the L's. Yeah. Well, give me a W then. Give me a okay. W. What's another guess on the top 10?
Okay, we've done fish, we've done birds. We've done insects, we've done birds. I'm going to say fish. I think fish are number two.
Fish are, in fact, number two. Yes, ma'am. So
now I'm
fish
on
are number
now
two.
Now I'm in the groove. Now I got it.
Yeah. Now you are not allowed to miss another guess for the rest of the episode. Okay?
No pressure.
Yeah, I think that's a reasonable ask. Yeah,
nice and low.
Fish is number two. There's 3.5 trillion of them, which means for every one human being, there is 44 fish. Which is a lot, but compare that to insects. For every one human, there was 1.4 billion insects. So now number two, the biggest population of non-insect animals is fish, For every one human, there's 44 of them.
But fish are a lot bigger than insects. So I feel like for every, you know, I feel like this is a little less, like, this is maybe a little more impressive than the insects, right? Because you're like, okay, yeah, well, a billion fish, that means something. This is like, this has weight.
Yeah, literally. But also fish, they range so much in their size. Because you can have little tiny, like, what's a small fish? Like a guppy. Like a guppy. And then you can also have the whale shark, which is considered a fish, I believe. And the cool thing about fish, too, is they're everywhere. They're the most abundant. They're abundant in most bodies of water, and they can be found in nearly all aquatic environments, from high mountain streams to the abyssal and even hadal. I don't know what that word is. Hadal depths of the deepest oceans. So, and like those would be cusk eels and snailfish are two examples they give. But they say, does this sound right, that no fish has been found in the deepest 25% of the ocean?
I mean, I don't know if that's because, maybe that might just be because not very much of the deepest parts of the ocean have been explored, right? Like maybe we just haven't come across them yet. Like life at those depths can be really kind of few and far between. Stat that gets thrown around a lot that I don't know if this is true or not, but people say that we have explored more of the moon than we have of the ocean floor. Like we know more about the surface of the moon than we do about the floor of the ocean.
God, it's just fuck. I mean,
it's spooky down there.
It's spooky down there, but yeah, there's just so many creatures down there that we don't even know about. Who knows what kind of Loch Ness monster shit is down there. Like every time I hear a stat about the ocean, we actually did an episode, probably 2 years ago, I did an episode with my friend Alex about the largest bodies of water on Earth. And we talked a lot about like the vastness of the ocean and this unexplored things of the ocean. And yeah, I don't even know.
It's scary. I'm very scared of the ocean. I have major like thalassophobia. I have a lot of like reverent respect for it at a healthy distance. And you're not going to catch me out there, but I will. I love it from the safety of land.
You're not going to go to the beach.
I'm not even a beach person. I don't love the beach.
Weren't you
from
Florida? Weren't you from Florida?
And here I did. I left.
Well, you won't even go to the beach?
Even when we do visit Florida, I still don't go to the beach. It's not my vibe at all. I don't like...
Ellen, this is another L, I'm sorry to say.
This is honestly, like, I'm such a bummer of a person, but, like, I will kind of, like, walk around, and I like to, like, look at shells and pick up little, like, you know, I like to look for little critters in the sand and stuff, but I'm not... I think it's because I know what's out there, and I'm like...
And you know what's... And you don't know what's out there, too.
It's an unfortunate mix of both. You're right in that sort of, like, what is that, the Dunning-Kruger sort of, like you know a little bit enough to, like, have a, to, like, think you know a lot about it. And I'm like, oh, but it's too much. It's too much.
Hey there, listener. Do you enjoy the Tennis Podcast? Of course you like it. Otherwise, then what the hell are you doing here? And since you enjoy the Tennis Pod, I'm asking you to do me, Dr. Buster, not Nick. I know you wouldn't do it for Nick, but please, please, please just do me a simple favor. Pause the episode right now and rate Tennis Podcast 5 stars on your podcasting app of choice. Is that Spotify? Is it Apple? Is it Good Pods? Is it whatever the hell else? I don't even know. It's like 100 different podcast hosting sites now. And so many other apps have a quick and simple way to rate the Tennis Pod 5 stars with just one tap. You do not even have to tap it 5 times to get 5 stars. Only one tap. I mean, come on. How much easier can we make it? It might not seem like much, but it really helps us out. And if you're feeling extra cheeky, then hey, write a quick review too. Your reviews help other people discover our show and gives you a chance to let Nick know that Dr. Buster is your favorite sidekick host. Take a few seconds to rate and review Tennis Podcast now. It's so easy, but very much appreciated. We want to say thank you for everything that you all do to support the show. Thank you very much.
When you were talking, I was glancing back at my notes and I saw an interesting random fact I wanted to share. This is so weird. So most people, when they think of a fish, and I know this is true for me, you think of a fish, it's this dumb animal who doesn't think, doesn't care, doesn't know, doesn't. But, and I've actually heard it said that fish don't feel pain. I don't know where that thought originated, but
I bet it originated from people who wanted to sell you fish and like, didn't want you to worry
about
it. I think a lot of it comes from people who like sell goldfish for you to keep in a bowl, and they say it's okay, you can keep them in a bowl with no filter, and like you can keep them in horrible conditions, they don't feel pain. Like I think it's from that.
I think you're right. That's a great point. Well, there was a study. There was a guy named William Tavolga. He did experiments on a toadfish, and found, have you heard this?
I don't think so. No, I don't know very much about toadfish.
He found that he would, this is terrible, but he would electrically shock this toadfish over and over. And it came to the point that when he would bring up the electrode to shock it, the toadfish would actually grunt at the sight.
He said, no, thank you. Please don't.
The thought of a fish just going, like grunting,
like, ugh.
Yeah.
It's just so human. It's also so human, like, for them to be like, we need to confirm that they can really feel pain. Like,
yeah, why don't we just assume that they can and call it a day? Because every other living thing, I think, could feel pain. So why do we need to prove this? I think this guy just wanted to shock a fish.
Yes. We need to study.
Thank you.
Well, there
how about we study cures for cancer or something instead? Like, what are we? We're putting resources towards shocking this poor innocent fish until it grunts.
Maybe give the fish the benefit of the doubt here.
Thank you. That's what I'm saying.
There have been a lot of really, really cool studies specifically on goldfish, like intelligence. And goldfish are surprisingly, first of all, like the whole thing about them having like a 3-second memory, total bullshit. They have months at least of memory. You can teach them to do tricks. You can teach them routines. Like you can teach them to like expect certain things, and then like they'll have a routine that they'll go through. So like if you have like there was a study where they showed them like a lever that they had to press, and if they pressed the lever at the right time, they would get food. If they pressed it outside of the right time, they wouldn't get anything. So they stopped pressing the lever unless it was the time that they knew. They're like, okay, it's 12 p.m. This is time for me to press the lever. So like they could like learn a routine and then not bother wasting their time outside of their routine. Like they knew what was the correct thing to do and wouldn't do it if it wasn't the right thing to do.
Like, who would ever think a goldfish is capable of that? But you know what they should have done? Instead of pressing the lever, they should have just grunted.
It's funny to me. I was like, you know what? We can't let the like major corporations find out that like fish can be trained to like perform tasks like that, because then we're gonna have like some horrible large scale fish labor operation.
I think something like that probably is already out there.
Oh no. Uh-oh, it's probably already happening. I can hear boardrooms across the country going, write that down.
Well, yeah, you give humans any sort of information and they will take it and make the world a worse place. They'll do things to make the world a better place too, but there's good and bad, as we know.
Start now. Unionize the fish. Unionize fish early. Get those labor laws in place.
3.5 trillion fish need to be labor in the
we need fish labor union laws.
Yes, I hope you will join me in this union of guessing another animal.
Okay. All right, so we've done insects, fish, and birds. That sucks, because unfortunately that was a lot of my that was a lot of what I already had in the tank, so I'm a little low on good guesses now.
Now you told me you would not miss another guess.
You're right. Spiders.
No spiders.
Oh my god, I've let you down.
Let's think bigger. Let's go bigger. Much bigger than, physically, I mean, animal, than what we've talked about.
Okay, physically bigger than any other animal we've talked about. Are they mammals?
Yes, in fact, I'm looking. I believe, yes, every single animal from here on out is a mammal.
Oh, okay. All right, that tells me something. Let me think. Mammals that there would be a lot of. And you've already said cats.
You know, side thing real quick. I have to assume they're including spiders in insects. Maybe they're just including all bugs, because it's like, how could spiders not be on this list otherwise?
Spiders would have to be on there.
Yeah.
There's so many of those dudes.
I'm guessing that they're including that. But anyway, sorry. I knew it. So, they were all mammals.
They were inflating their numbers. It's big insect is what it is.
That's what it is.
I'm going to say cows. I bet cows are on there.
I'll give you this one. It's cattle, which includes cows. And so do you have a rough estimate for where on the list it might be?
Let's see. put it at, we've already done the top three. I'm going to say it's maybe four.
You take four and you add two and you'll get six, which is number six, cattle.
So I was basically right.
No, another L.
What's the scoreboard looking like? It's not good for me.
I don't even want to talk about the scoreboard because it'll depress all of us. Cattle, there's 1.5 billion of these some bitches on here. And they're, for every one human, there's 0.19 of this animal. So there's more humans than cattle. So cattle includes female cattle like cows, male cattle like bulls, as well as steer, oxen, and heifers. And as we all know, cattle have played a key role in human history, having been domesticated since at least about 10,000 years ago. Cattle provide milk, meat, and hides, contributing to our dietary needs and industries. And in fact, dairy by itself is a large industry worldwide. India produces 94 million tons of milk per year, making it the largest milk producer. And that industry in India alone employs 80 million people. Just from pulling the teat of this animal until milk comes out. Like, you know, it's just crazy. Like, if you were to boil down the milking industry, which employs 80 million people just in India, much less everywhere else, it all boils down to someone just sitting next to a cow pulling on its tit until milk comes out. Like, that's
wild.
It
is already inherently a little bit strange that we drink the milk of a different species.
The only reason it's not weird is because it's normalized.
Right. Like, we all agreed we're all cool with it.
Yeah. but if you think about it, same with like eggs and stuff like that. If you think about it, it's really kind of weird and gross.
I can't think of any other animal that drinks the milk of another species. Like, I can think of a lot of animals that eat the eggs of other species. That's totally normal. But, like, drinking the milk is, like, a step beyond, I think. Like, that gets into, like, that's for their babies. Like, what do you, like, it seems a little unusual. And I find it, I have to wonder what the process would have been like in, like, human history to, like, discover that we could do that.
I always think about that. Same with... Like, because like the eggs, like, you could think, well, they looked around and saw that other animals eat the eggs of other animals. But they could not look around and say, oh, look, that giraffe over there is sucking the tit of an elephant and getting milk out of it. They, like, there was no frame of reference to make that jump. So somewhere, someone had to say, I'm going to try this milk. And, oh, it's not so bad. And then it just evolves from there. But man, cattle got it rough, man, because if it's not their milk we're after, then it's fucking their meat, right? It's like, they have no respite. We want every part of the cattle.
I would rather us use every part of the animal, like, if we're going to already be, like, having this industry based on, like, harvesting this animal's body, I would rather us be using every part of it instead of, like, letting part of it go to waste. But like, also, you think about, like, a dairy cow, they have been bred over thousands of years to be, like, as milkable as possible. And so that makes me wonder, like, thousands of years ago, before, you know, their udders were maybe more, like, pronounced and accessible than they are now, like, it would have been a little more tricky to get the milk, I think. Like, I have to imagine what that would have looked like a few thousand years ago.
And you have to assume also that, look, I'm sorry, but I would guess that the first person to drink cow's milk took it straight from the source, like, mouth to, and I'm not even saying that to be funny. Like, I'm saying, because I think, like, that's how everyone has got, that's how babies get milk from, human babies get milk from their mother. Yeah. Like, who would ever think to, like, jack off the tit and to get milk out of it? Like,
I could see them seeing a baby cow doing it and then being like, maybe there's something here. Like, let them cook. Maybe they're onto something.
Let them cook.
Maybe they'll just, like, kick the calf to the side and be like, kind of like Indiana Jones, like, sort of, like,
oh,
knock the calf
off
and just, mm-hmm, like, yeah, just swap themselves right in. Be like, let me see what this is all about.
I think, I mean, it's probably not too far off from that.
I eat way too much cheese to talk any amount of shit about the dairy industry. I'm
a slave to cheese. Like, seriously.
Biggest cheese slut imaginable.
Cheese slut.
And
I did not
expect about it either. Like, I will just straight up shredded, straight out of the bag, holding it over your face, kind of, like, it does not matter.
Okay,
so, like, whatever
I
the process was that
cheese
brought us to cheese, like, I'm cool with it. Whatever kind of weird little, I will look the other way, however we got here, whatever got us to cheese.
Well, I feel that way about, like, when I hear about, you know, the farming industry and, like, you know, how cows are butchered. Like, it makes me feel guilty about eating a burger, but I'm willing to look the other way because I like that burger too much. You know,
I will always like make choices for, you know, like if I happen to know that like a brand is like a good ethical brand that treats their animals well. And like, ultimately, like, let's not take the guilt onto ourselves as consumers for the crimes of the industry. Like, let's maybe put the pressure on them to get their shit together. Like, maybe you guys can bear the brunt of this guilt, and maybe we can just pressure them into doing things correctly. But when it comes to cheese, God, I don't know what I would do without cheese. Cheese, I have a problematic relationship with.
So I think the words you used were cheese slut, in fact.
Yeah, straight up.
But for more on animals and eating them and all the ways that industries whore out their bodies for us humans to enjoy, listen to episode 173 from our archives where we cover the top 10 most consumed animals on Earth. Now, one last thing for you is that despite our dependency on these animals, not just for food and dairy, but for their hides, things like that, the industries surrounding cattle produce an alarming amount of greenhouse gas emissions. Cattle are responsible for around 7% of global greenhouse gas emissions. And Ellen, did you know that the gut flora of cattle produce methane, a powerful greenhouse gas, as a byproduct of enteric fermentation? And each cow belches out 100 kilograms a year.
That is a lot. I had heard about the relationship between cows and methane. Didn't realize it was coming out that end, though. I guess I assumed that was all sort of a bit. Oh, yeah. You're probably getting both barrels there, I think.
Yeah. I think the only animal that produces more kilograms per belch is probably our friend Dr. Buster, but we don't have to talk more about that. So you got cattle at number 6. There is another animal that you might find on a farm near the cattle.
I'm going to go pig. I'm going to go pig.
Are there more or less pigs than cows?
Do I think there's more or less pigs? I'm trying to think about, like, are pigs eaten in more places than cows are? And I think so. So I'm going to say there's more pigs than cows.
Yeah, I would have thought so too, but they're actually right behind at number 7.
Wow. Whoa, yeah. This number five spot is elusive to me.
Elusive? What is number 5? I got to remind myself. Oh, that's a fun one. Okay, number 7. There are 1 billion pigs, which means for every one human, there's about 0.13 pigs. Pigs are farmed primarily for meat, which is called pork. The animal skin or hide is used for leather. The world's largest pork producer is China, followed by the European Union, and then the United States in third. Beyond their status as a food source, pigs offer services in other domains, such as medical research, due to their physiological similarities to humans. Now, this count does include things like wild boars, which have a tense relationship with human communities around the world.
Especially in quantities of 30 to 50.
Yes. Because of their relative lack of sweat glands, pigs do what, Ellen, to cool down?
They wallow,
which is...
It's so cute. They roll around in the mud.
I do like watching a pig wallow, as it were.
Do you know they can swim?
No.
Yeah, there's I think it's in the Bahamas. There's an island where there's a feral colony of pigs. And the pigs live on the beach and they swim in the water. You can look up videos online of these like Bahama pigs that just live in the island.
I'm literally putting a reminder in my phone right now to look this up.
Watch videos of swimming pigs.
I love pigs. I think they are the cutest animal. And it's upsetting because on one hand, I fucking love bacon, Ellen. I love bacon. I'm a bacon slut. And sausage is good. Ham is good.
It's pork really belly like pork for me. Chops. Pork belly.
Oh, pork belly. Oh, my God. Like pulled pork. But I'm so sad when I see a pig and know that it's just going to be slaughtered. I like pet pigs, too. So
pet pigs are good. Pet pigs are also often marketed deceptively because you'll get like someone who's really trying to sell these pigs and they'll be like, it's a micro pig. It's a teacup pig. It'll only get up to, you know, they won't tell you that they'll still get up to 300-400 pounds. Like these things will get huge and it will be a whole ordeal.
Still cute, though.
They're so cute, and they're smart. They're so clever.
That's my next note, is that they are roughly on par with dogs in intelligence. Mm-hmm.
They distinguish 100%.
Each other as individuals. They spend time in play. They form structured communities. They have good long-term memory. They experience emotions. They change their behavior in response to the emotional states of other pigs. They perform tasks that that require them to identify the location of objects. They can solve mazes. They can work with the simple language of symbols, and they display self-recognition in a mirror.
This all just upsets
me more, because, like, I know there's some societies that eat dog, but for the most part, most of the world do not eat dog, and one of the reasons is because they're seen as so smart, and they're man's best friend. But the pig is just as smart as the dog, or at least pretty close, and we have no problem just shoving a million of them in the small little pig pen and then taking them out to cut their throat. You know, it's just...
It does make you wonder, like, where do we draw the line? Like, it seems kind of arbitrary how we decide, like, what we are and are not okay with, like, industrializing. Like, how do we decide? And, like, why are we kind of weird about horses? Like, why are we kind of weird about, like, I would imagine, I would say, at least where I live in the United States, horse meat is not, like, there's kind of a taboo against it. Not in other places in the world. They're totally cool with it. So I'm like, why do we have an ick about it?
It's true. It is weird. And, you know, again, like I said earlier with, I think it was about dairy, how it only doesn't seem weird because it's so normalized. Same with pork and pigs. It's and any animal, really. It's like, it's just, it's always been that way. So... Thus, it's normal. And then when you hear of another country that eats dogs, that's not normal to you, and it sounds weird. Same with the horse example you gave. So it's just, that's cultures. Cultures evolve differently, and different animals have different meanings there.
Maybe if pigs had evolved alongside humans with some type of, like, they were providing some sort of service to us the way that dogs do, right? Because dogs kind of grow up providing a sort of service for us. So... we have this relationship to them that, like, we're incentivized to care for them and keep them alive for a long time and, like, care for them and make sure they're, like, healthy and well-fed and stuff. So I wonder if maybe if we had tapped into their potential, like, for performing tasks, like, maybe we would have had a different relationship with them.
So dogs, huh?
Yeah.
Interesting animal, dogs.
Are they on the list?
I don't know. Do you want to guess if they're on the list officially?
I do. I want to guess that they're on the list. I want to guess that they're above cows.
You guess wrong because they are on the list, but they're number 9.
Okay. All right. This makes sense. Dogs are kind of big. They require a lot of resources to care for. So I could see them, yeah, coming up, bringing up the rear.
And this includes all dogs, including wild dogs, wolves, things like that. I think wolves.
So, like, canines, I guess.
Canine, yeah.
Zooming out.
900 million of these in the world, which means for every one human, there is 0.11 of the dog. It was the first species to be domesticated and has been selectively bred over millennia for various behaviors, sensory capabilities, and physical attributes. And the genetic divergence between dogs and wolves occurred somewhere between 20 and 40,000 years ago. And they're very smart. Some studies say they compare to the intelligence of a 2-year-old human.
Mm-hmm.
Some dogs can even learn up to 1,000 words. They possess up to, so that's it on intelligence. I'm going to shift now to their nose, their sense of smell. Because if you know a dog, one of their defining traits is they love to smell shit. Literally and figuratively. They love to walk around and smell things. Yes. They possess up to, well, actually, let me start with the human nose possesses 6 million olfactory receptors. The dog's nose, 300 million. 300 million compared to 6.
So they're smelling circles around us. They're absolutely clearing us.
Close. Well, it's like when you hear a stat like that and the next one that I'm about to read, it's like, of course they're smelling shit all the time because it's just this overpowering sense that's constant. Like, their smells are in the air all around us. Humans are less sensitive to them, but dogs, every little thing, they're smelling. Because also, the part of the brain that is devoted to analyzing smells is 40 times greater in the dog than in the human.
So they have invested a lot of sort of real estate in the old noggin into interpreting smells.
It serves them well.
It's kind of like with our powers combined, because, like, they have this really, really heightened sense of smell, but they don't see as well, whereas, like, humans have this, like, are more visually, like, oriented, so, like, we have really strong vision and weaker smell. So between the two of us, you know, when you team up together, like, we've got vision covered and they've got smell covered, it makes kind of a devastating combo.
And we just need cats for the hearing, right?
See, now you've got the whole family in on it.
Speaking of, 38% of households own an average of 1.6 dogs per house in the U.S. That comes out to about 77 million domestic dogs in the U.S. But not all dogs are living in the home, because in the developed world, like in America, most dogs are owned by people. But in the developing world, dogs are more commonly feral or communally owned, with pet dogs being uncommon. And most of those dogs live their whole lives as scavengers, never owned by a human.
Yeah, there's, I think there's a stronger street dog culture, right? Like the dogs just kind of like wander around the streets and they're just, they're everybody's friend. It's not any one person's dog. This is our dog, collectively.
I just hope someone's being nice to him out there. Not mistreating him, you know.
There's probably a little bit of both, right?
A little bit of both, yeah.
A little sweet and a little sour.
Yeah. So that is the dog, man's best friend. I love a good dog, Ellen. Tell ya.
I love a good dog. I'm such a dog person.
I lost my dog a few months ago. So I am.
Oh, that's the worst.
I'm between dogs. I'll get another dog someday. I'm not ready just yet, but I've always had dogs, love dogs. That's all. I just wanted to say I love them.
I feel like they deserve a little honorable mention, a little star next to, like, this is our buddy. This is.
Yeah, well, they've been so important to the development of humans and society.
Yeah, and, like, dogs have even evolved to adapt to us, like, you've got, like, working dogs that, the physiological diversity of dogs is insane to me because, like, I feel like there's no other species that has so much phenotypic variation where, like, you put two individuals of the same species up next to each other, there's no way in 1,000 years you'd think those two were the same species. They look like completely different creatures. But, like, you put, like, a pug and, like, a husky next to each other, and you're like, those do not look the same species at all. But for dogs, like, we've just, like, done so much to kind of tailor them to our needs. But also, like, if you look at a wolf has much fewer muscles in its face to control things like its eyebrows, and it's like, it doesn't communicate as much with its face. But dogs, first of all, they have more muscles in their eyebrows to give their eyes more expression, because humans communicate.
Humans depend on that. Yeah.
Yeah, like, that's how we read each other's expressions, is with, like, eyebrow position. So dogs have started to move their eyebrows to, like, indicate emotion. Like,
that's why this whole episode, my brow's been, like, furrowed at Ellen, like, the whole time, being like, really?
You've been mean mugging me the whole time. Nobody listening really can tell. But also, like, the whites of their eyes are, like, more pronounced than in wolves, because it helps humans see which direction they're looking in. So, like, it's interesting to see the ways that, like, a dog's body has, like, adjusted to humans. Like, yeah. We really are just kind of, way. Like, together.
Cats, because I've heard, maybe you'll burst my bubble like you did about the chicken and the T-Rex earlier, but what I've heard is that cats developed meowing as a way to primarily communicate with humans. They don't really meow at each other much.
I've heard that too. Yeah, 100%. Yeah. Yeah, I've definitely heard that, like, when humans aren't around, cats are like, we're done with that, right?
They just grunt like the fish.
It's like I feel like meowing is like their customer service voice.
That's their Karen voice, yeah. Well, real quick, before you guess another thing, I want to take a really quick break to ask you a very random question, completely off topic. I'm going to describe a movie plot poorly, and you're going to tell me the name of the movie.
Okay. I've seen like 8 movies in my life, so here we go. This is going to be great. I hope it's one of the ones I've seen.
I'll bet you've seen this one. Something about you just tells me you've seen this. A farm boy gets radicalized by an old man and proceeds to join a terrorist organization to commit mass murder on the government.
Farm boy radicalized
by an old man.
By an old man. Oh, man.
Joins a terrorist organization to commit mass murder against the government.
Against the government.
It's a classic movie.
This is going to be one where it turns out he's incredibly based. Is it perhaps radicalized by an old man against the government? I'm thinking movies where the government is the bad guy.
Maybe even the empire? Maybe even an empire might be a bad guy.
Oh, it's a Star Wars.
Star Wars, A New Hope.
Yes, yep. Episode 4. Oh, man, my husband would be in tears if he knew that I didn't immediately clock a Star Wars movie.
It was a tough one, I'll be honest. A farm boy gets radicalized by an old man. Yeah.
But I totally see it now.
Yeah. Well, the reason I ask you that...
He does, when he blows the Death Star, like, there was people working there. Like,
he's murdering, mass murdering government employees. Yes, absolutely.
He has an insane KDR.
Don't worry, though, the Death Star inexplicably returns for, what is the first Disney one? What's that called?
They're like, we had a couple of them in the back, it's fine.
Yeah, that's true. Well, anyway, I asked you that because this is a plug for our new bonus episode where I brought dozens of poorly explained plot summaries just like this to my friend Alex Johns and had him attempt to guess the movie for each one. I kept his score, and now I want you, listener, to see if you can beat Alex's score. Listen to this new bonus episode. It's out now for Tennis Pod Plus members, which, by the way, is just what we call our Patreon. You can get bonus episodes like that one, as well as ad-free versions of our main episodes, like the one you're listening to now. And you can listen to all those in the same podcast app you're already using. You don't have to download anything new. Just go to tennispod.com/PLUS to sign up. You can also sign up in the Apple Podcasts app. Either way, you get a free 7-day trial. But unlike Tennis Pod Plus, what's not free is Ellen's next guess. We got to pay for that one. Ellen, give me another animal.
I'm going to start being way smarter about these guesses now that I know that these aren't free. These babies are coming at a premium.
So you're going to be a little less ant and a little more pig in your guesses.
So what numbers do I have left still? I think I still have 4.
That is a good reminder for me to go through the list. So far, you're missing 10, 9 is dog. You're missing 8, 7 is pig, 6 is cattle. You're missing 5 and 4, 3 is birds, 2 is fish, and 1 is insect.
Are rabbits on here?
No, they're one of the ones that were excluded.
That's right.
Because
that's
of,
right, you said. Yeah. And you said rats were also excluded?
Yep. And okay. Reptiles.
I'm going to go with, then, I'm trying to think of other super common mammals, then.
I'll give you
squirrels?
A hint. Nope.
No, that's a
rabbit. I wish. I love squirrels, but number 10 is another animal you'll find on the farm. Actually, number 8 is too.
Sheep?
Sheep.
Aww. I love sheep.
What number?
At...
You need 10, 8, 5, and 4.
I'm going to put them at 8.
8, your first W Excellent. Of the day.
Put them numbers.
1 billion of these guys, 0.13 sheep for every one human. Whether it is in the wind-swept highlands of Scotland or the rugged landscapes of New Zealand, the presence of sheep has significantly shaped both the physical and economic terrains. They stand as a testament to humanity's age-old resilience on animal resources and our profound influence on shaping animal demographics on a global scale. It's one of the earliest animals to be domesticated for agricultural purposes. They're raised for their fleece and their meat, and their milk. A sheep's wool is the most widely used animal fiber and is usually harvested by shearing. And sheep are an important part of the global agricultural economy. However, their once vital status has been largely replaced by other livestock species like the pig, chicken, and cow.
I am a recent convert into the wool lifestyle because coming from Florida, wool... not exactly super useful there. Didn't really have any wool. But now that I live up in the Pacific Northwest, now I am a wool girly.
You think it's comfortable?
It is really nice. It's actually very, very nice. I like it. I like wool now.
And the great thing about the wool is you don't have to kill the sheep to get the wool. The sheep wants you to shear it off the wool. Sheep have a tendency to congregate, and they become stressed when they're separated from their flock members. And usually it says there's really no leader or pack leader of a sheep. It's more so that whichever sheep is the first to move will be the one that's followed by the other sheep, is what I have here. So it's like, you might think, like, for a pack of wolves, for example, there's usually one wolf that's the pack leader and you follow him. But with sheep, they're just following whichever some bitch moves first. So,
there's a lesson in initiative there.
Yeah.
You'd be a real go-getter type. And everyone will follow.
Yeah, I don't want to eat this grass patch anymore. I want to eat that one over there.
This one, the vibes are off. No good. We'll go over there.
You think about the thought process of a sheep. I mean, it's probably like an individual ant.
Based on what I've heard about sheep from people who like live and work with sheep, there's not much thought process to speak of. I think it's mostly just kind of...
We know you like to listen to Tennis Podcast, but now it's time to wear it. Tennispod.com/merch has all of your merch needs. We have new designs that let the world know you're a sidekick host, or that your loved ones should just go ahead and unsubscribe. All these and more are available to wear on your tight little body right now. We also have designs for the licking machine, your body elves, and many others. We even have one that proves you have one hell of an ass. We have shirts available for all sexes and multiple colors available, as well as mugs, hoodies, and hats. And to help you get started, I have a special discount for you. Use promo code BUTT for 10% off your next order. That's promo code BUTT at tennispod.com/MERCH. Don't be a butt. Shop now.
They're mostly just concerned with not dying from one second to the next, and that seems to be kind of their primary motivator.
Bah.
Yep, I agree.
They're quite anxious creatures.
They are. And I think there's another anxious creature that we should talk about. This is our last farm animal, and it's number 10.
It's the goat.
It's the goat. Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
The goat is number 10. There's 850 million of those. For every one human, there's 0.11 goats. It is a member of the family Bovidae?
Oh, so they're like related to cows then, like bovines.
Okay. Yeah. Well, it says here it's meaning it's closely related to the sheep.
I think goats and sheep are more closely related, and then cows are kind of like a little bit farther out from them. But sheep and goats are like, yeah, they are like twinsies.
Yeah. Well, there's over 300 distinct breeds of goat, and it is one of the oldest domesticated species of animal. There's evidence of goats being part of human society going back 10,000 years. They've been used for milk, meat, fur, and skins across much of the world. You looked it up, I can tell.
I was looking up something that I'm going to tell you about in just a second. That I was making sure I remembered the name correctly. I was making sure that I had something because I wanted to really drop a bomb on you.
I'm ready. Okay, so before that, let me tell you that the goat, one reason they're so useful is because they're known for their hardiness and adaptability. Goats thrive in a myriad of environments, from the precipitous mountains of the Himalayas to the arid landscapes of the Sahara. And their robust presence across diverse ecological niches highlights their significant role in subsistence farming and pastoral cultures, contributing to local economies and livelihoods in many parts of the world.
Goats do not give a fuck. They do not care at all. Anywhere is fine for a goat. They're like, this is all good.
It's true. Not just where they are, but what they eat. They'll go anywhere. They'll eat anything.
Eat out of your trash.
I was at the zoo recently, and there's a petting zoo section in the zoo. And you go in, and you just, little kids are running up to the goat. And most animals, like my cat who's sitting next to me, would fucking book it the other direction if a kid came running up to it. But a goat, and I know it's used to it being inside the petting zoo and all that, but the goat is unfazed by a child running toward it.
I think it's because they know that they could fuck that kid up if they had to. They're like, you know what? That kid doesn't have horns. Like, I'm set. If it comes to blows, they're like, I'm taking this kid out. Like, no problem. No questions asked.
And they won't feel bad about it.
Goats are so chaotic. And when I was a kid one time, I remember being in a petting zoo, and I had this like lanyard with a little watch on the end of it. And so I'm in this petting zoo petting the little animals, and I feel my lanyard kind of like tugging on my neck. And I was like, what the hell is that? And I turn and look, and a goat has my watch completely in its mouth and is like attempting to chew on it. I was like, you stupid idiot. What the hell are you doing? No. Like,
why are you being mean to the goat? He's trying to get a snack.
This doesn't even look edible. Like, you've seen plastic before. You know you can't eat this.
That's where you're wrong, because they will eat plastic.
They do not care. Absolutely. They're like, yum, 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 delicious.
Yeah, they really are. It's wild. So what's the fact you looked up?
Well, so I wanted to know if you've ever seen a Damascus goat.
Maybe. What is that?
Could you do a quick Google for me real quick?
Damascus?
Could you take a quick glance at a Damascus goat?
Oh.
It's a lot to take in, isn't it?
It's a lot to take in. I will put a link to an image of the Damascus goat in the show notes for our listeners. But yes, this is interesting. I've never seen this.
It's Lovecraftian. In form, I think.
Well, this is weird because I see some that have really long ears.
See, that's what's so weird about these goats is that they are so incomprehensible in like form of their face that you can't really tell what you're looking at. You're like, is this ear? Is this throat? Like, what, is this a dewlap of some kind? Like, what are we working with here?
I am very confused. My brain doesn't want to accept.
Nope.
I don't care for these. So goats can come in many, many forms.
Oh my god, I'm looking at one of it's like the skeleton of its skull.
I would hate to see that. I would not like to see that. It's a little incomprehensible of a creature.
I'm gonna save this image. Damn. Okay, thanks for that.
It's just a fun little thing about goats. I like goats. I think they're cool. This is one. Oh, I do actually have a fun, interesting thing to say about goats really quick. So you see how, you know how like when you look at a goat, their eyes look kind of weird because their pupils are like horizontal shaped.
Yes.
So that's common among a lot of animals that do a lot of grazing on grass because they need to kind of scan the horizon and see if there's like a predator coming for them. So like sheep, I think horses also will have horizontal shaped pupils. But if you think about it, your pupils are horizontally shaped. That's fine. When you lower your head to graze on the grass, your eyes are now no longer going to be at the same angle that they were when your head was upright. So, for grazing animals like goats, when they do lower their head, the pupil, the eyeball rotates in its socket to stay level with the horizon, like tilts to the side so that their pupil is still like running across the horizon.
So, and they do that, I assume, so they can still monitor for predators while grazing.
Yeah. So they can see if someone's coming up on them and they still have that kind of like wide landscape of view. Isn't that crazy?
Now, why can't humans have, like, humans, we got nothing like
Apparently,
that.
we like people keep telling me, "Oh, we can do it too." I've tried it. I've like tried so many different ways to
You've
like
gone
get my
outside and
eyes to do
grazed
this.
and tried to
I
put
was
your
like
eyes up?
looking in the mirror and tilting my head around, and I was like using my camera to try. I got nothing. So like apparently we can do this, but like a little tiny bit. But goats are fully like they're just about like whirligigging all around in there.
Gigging. That's a word. But I like the idea better that you were like out in the pasture
Tried
eating
so hard.
grass, like getting your
Sticking
eyes
my
up.
head down, like there's got to be something here.
That is interesting. I didn't know that. Well, because yeah, we've all seen the horizontal goat eyes, but no, most of us haven't like thought through like why that is, other than it looks interesting.
I love eyeballs.
I am indifferent toward eyeballs, but I do love animal guesses, and I'd love for you to give me number four or five, which
So
are the last two you need.
horses. Do we got horses?
Horses are number 14 on the list with 58
So
million.
close. Okay, so we've got four and five left. Are we still in animal or still in mammal territory?
We have both of these are mammals. I
Okay,
could give you a
okay.
pretty big hint on one of them, but I'll see if you can guess it first before I give too big of a hint.
Okay, and we've excluded rodents. Is raccoons perhaps on the list?
No, but rodents, these could these some people consider these rodents, even though they're technically not.
Let me think. Bats.
Bats. You
Yes.
got it. You got it. I didn't think you'd get that so quick, but you got it. Bats. It's interesting because unlike birds or insects or fish, which as a human living in the world, you see those all the time. Like you go outside and you'll see that stuff. But bats, you really don't see them out and about that often. And that's because a lot of reasons, but they love dark caves and they're nocturnal and all that stuff. There's at least 10 billion bats estimated, and there's some estimates that have them up to 100 billion, which, if true, they'd actually overtake birds in the third spot. But I have them at their minimum, which is 10 billion, puts them at number four, which means for every one human, there's at least 1.25 bats.
Oh, I love bats.
I think they're pretty cute.
They're so cute.
Yeah. But they love to suck blood out of animals, so
Well,
you gotta.
only three species are vampire bats.
Yeah.
There's only three, and only one of them of the vampire bat species has it really like poses any sort of even like I don't think any of them have ever I don't know if any of them have ever been documented actually like sucking blood from a human. Maybe they have. They're found in like Mexico and Central America. They're really not as big a deal, I think, as people make them out to be, but like the vast
No, it's because of
majority
the whole
of
vampire
bats,
lore.
which is interesting because the vampire lore came from Eastern Europe. The vampire bat came from Mexico. So like it was a very sort of like recent, only within the last couple of like maybe like the last 100 years or so that they became associated with each other. Like vampire and bat mythology like converged. Super recent, like way more recent than I thought it was. But like vampire bats are like from
Yeah,
the
well, I
other
want to
side of
say
the world.
Dracula was came out, I want to say like the 1880s or something like that, late 1800s. So yeah, it's relatively recently. And then of course you have Batman, also known for sucking blood out of animals.
That's a huge thing he does.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's the defining trait.
That's why he's called Batman. Not a lot of people know
Right.
that.
Yeah. No, you're right. But bats, as you might know, are the only mammals capable of true and sustained flight. No other mammal can fly, at least not truly and sustainably.
Yeah, this is differentiated from gliding, because you have a lot of, like, animals that can glide, but
like
they can't,
like... flying squirrel or whatever.
Yeah, which is really just, like, fancy falling. They can just kind of fall forward, but a bat can actually generate lift, which is pretty cool.
Yes, they can, yeah. That's a good way to put it. There's over 1,400 species of bats, and bats represent 20% of all mammals.
Now that, like, I remember hearing all this stuff before, and now I'm so embarrassed that it took me so long to get to bats.
Well, bats are not an animal that's top of mind for people.
They really
Ironically, given Dracula and given Batman, so, like, those things are top of mind in, like, the zeitgeist. But bats, the animal, you really don't think about them that much in everyday
life. They're siloed into, like, the goth animals.
They're, they're their own thing, too, since they're the only mammal that can fly. But they are present throughout the world, with the exception of extremely cold places. Otherwise, they're everywhere. They're extremely important in ecosystems because they pollinate flowers, they disperse seeds, and many tropical plants depend entirely on bats for these services. And due to their physiology, bats are one type of animal that acts as a natural reservoir of many pathogens, such as rabies. And since they are highly mobile, social, and long-lived, they can readily spread disease among themselves. And if humans interact with bats, these traits become potentially dangerous to humans.
Don't go grabbing bats. It is. You want to go ahead and leave those alone.
Yeah, don't kiss a bat if you can help.
No, let them have their space.
Yeah, they don't want to be near you anyway.
No, this is a purely spectator relationship.
Yes. They are, I love bats though. I love watching bats. But like I said, they're kind of not top of mind. However, to contradict that, I'll say that depending on the culture, bats are sometimes symbolically associated with positive traits, such as protection from certain diseases or risks, rebirth, or long life. But in the West, which is where we live, bats are popularly associated with darkness, malevolence, witchcraft, vampires, and death. So they kind of got a stigma attached to them in Western culture.
Yeah, the bat stigma, like, goes way farther back than, like, the association with vampires, because people were like, I don't know, they seem like they got bad vibes, they seem evil adjacent, they're like, it's all the critters that are out at night. Yeah. So, you know, people already hated on bats, so I think it seemed, like, logical to slot them into vampire mythology. So, like, yeah, sure, put them together.
No, well, I mean, it is true. They're kind of like the spider of mammals. Right?
They are because the spider of mammals.
People in general don't like spiders. They're icked by spiders. They don't want to be near them. Bats are kind of the same. Even though, like, you can watch them on video and think they're cute, but you don't want to be near a bat because they carry diseases, they have sharp fangs, they can fly out of nowhere, there's usually a bunch at once, and they're nocturnal. They only come out at night. So, like, all that stuff combined, I think, is a recipe for the bat to be kind of misunderstood and feared.
Maligned. Bat.
Number five is all you need. And you haven't even got close to guessing this yet, surprisingly.
Okay. We're still in mammal territory. I've already said bats, so that was kind of my Hail Mary.
These guys are a lot bigger than the bat.
A lot bigger than bats. And we're out of farmland territory. We're out of the barnyard.
Well, technically you could find these on a farm, but not exclusively.
This is,
you're
unfortunately
gonna laugh when you hear it,
exposing my ignorance about farm.
not a lot of farms in Florida, Ellen?
Well, there are, but I already said all the things I know from the farm. Let's see. Let me think. I tried horses, and that didn't work.
I'm going to say that you have talked to this animal today.
I've talked to it. Oh, is it a human?
It's a human.
Oh! How could you do this to me?
You could find a human on a farm.
How could you possibly expose my anthropocentric bias that didn't consider humans to be among animals, a thing that I rag on people for doing on a daily basis? How could you possibly expose me like this?
I brought you on. The last hour plus of this episode has been building up to this moment where I expose you for the fraud that you are.
Oh my god. This has been a setup all along.
The human. There's 8 billion of us on the Earth, and I have some stats about the population growth in humans, but first let me take a step back and tell you that the modern human, which by the way is the only surviving Homo genus, or however you should phrase that, on the planet, right? There's only one species of human, Every other animal we've talked about, there's hundreds or thousands or millions of different species, but the human, there's just one.
Yeah, and it was surprisingly recently that there were other members of our genus. So, like, Neanderthal was a member of the Homo genus, and we lived together at the same time. So there were Homo sapiens and Homo neanderthalensis, like, at the same time, which is why a lot of us have a little bit of that in our little DNA makeup. I've got some.
I do. Okay. I haven't checked, but I'll bet I do too.
There was also like Homo floresiensis, which lived in like Indonesia. And I'm drawing a blank on some of the other ones, but like there were other members of our genus that lived around us at the same time. We're just the last ones left.
Probably because we killed off the others.
Or assimilated.
Assimilated, yes.
Integrated into sort of genetic, we mingled.
Are you sure humans really aren't really known to do that, Ellen? Are you sure?
Unfortunately.
Now, humans are known for their intelligence, and they're one of the most adaptable species, despite having a low or narrow tolerance for many of Earth's extreme environments. Currently, the species is present in all 8 biogeographical realms.
Up in Florida, I feel like maybe we're not meant to live there. I feel like maybe we weren't supposed to be there.
There's a lot of places we're not meant to live. I want to talk to the people in fucking Iceland and wherever else where it's like, you know, like, and parts of Africa that are like so hot. Like, there's these extreme climates that humans probably shouldn't be in, but we've managed to make it work.
It's a thumbs, baby.
Yeah, it really is. Well, and the intelligence. But estimates of the population at the time of agriculture emerged in around 10,000 BC have ranged between 1 and 15 million. So let's start keeping track. I'm going to throw a lot of numbers at you. In 10,000 BC, they estimate around 1 million on the low end and 15 million on the high end humans on Earth. Okay. Now, around 4th century AD, around the time of the Roman Empire, there were 50 to 60 million people living just in the Roman Empire.
Big jump there. Like,
that's
a big
jump.
Yeah. But over a long period of time. So, like,
15, 16,000 years. That's a big jump. But that jump is going to seem tiny here in a minute. Now, we reached 1 billion people in the year 1800.
Seems surprisingly recent.
Very. So, let's recap. 10,000 BC, we had, I'll cut it down the middle and say around 5-ish million people on Earth. Then you go forward 15,000 years to the height of the Roman Empire, and there's 60 million people just in the Roman Empire. So, you know, I don't know how many on Earth, but more than that. Then you go forward, let's see, 4th century AD to 1800. So that's what, like 1,400 years? Am I doing that right? 1,400 years later, we now have 1 billion people, and since then it's increased exponentially, reaching 2 billion in 1930, 3 billion in 1960, 4 billion in 1975, and 6 billion in 1999, 7 billion in 2011, and 8 billion in 2022.
So that is like, you can see like every like few years getting faster and faster, which I'd imagine is like a lot of like medical technology, right? Like just people just aren't dying as fast.
A lot of fucking too. But that's always been around. That's always been a thing. So, but what you said is right. Like the medical, the advances in science and medicine and technology have allowed humans to live longer, more prosperously, but also humans have spread. Yeah, I don't know. I mean,
like we can take advantage of like areas we weren't able to before. Like we can live in places that wouldn't have been accessible to us a few hundred years ago.
Yes, and I think we feel the need to populate those areas once we get there. And then over time, it just compounds. And so 1 billion people in 1800, just a little over 200 years ago, and now 8 billion. We've grown by 8x in 200 years, and this is another way to put it. It took over 2 million years of human history for the human population to reach 1 billion, and only 207 years to grow to 7 billion.
So that's like you mentioned, like exponential growth, right? Like kind of cramming. And that's kind of the way it feels too, really. It feels like every 10 years or so, like it feels like the difference between now and 10 years ago is so much different from between 10 and 20 years ago. Like everything feels like it's kind of on fast forward and getting a little faster.
Well, think like the Industrial Revolution was what, the 1700s or 1800s? Like, there's a pretty big difference between then and now. And now, if you and that's the last 200 or 300 years. And if you take the last 200 or 300 years and compare it to the 200 or 300 years before that, it's like not even night and day. It's like Earth and Pluto. I don't know, pick your thing, but like there's such a difference between the way humans used to live and how they live now.
I think that a lot of times this like conversation about like the rapidly growing human population, I think, can sometimes get into really dicey sort of like territory where you can get into, I don't know, blaming people for having children, you know what I mean? Like blaming people basically for like contributing to an overpopulation crisis, which is like, I mean, you know, people are going to have children. This is just going to be what it is. Like, you know, the bigger sort of, I think, concern is that like resources are being sequestered in a way that like the population is growing, not in excess of what the planet can provide, but in excess of what humans are willing to allow each other to access.
Yes. Like, it goes with my quote at the beginning.
Yeah. Like,
remember my quote?
Like, everyone could be fine.
Yes, exactly.
Fine.
But humans won't allow. That's why we can't have nice things. Because humans ruin everything. And yeah, I want to like give humans their flowers. They've done a lot of amazing things, and we're living comfortably talking on the internet to each other because of human genius and all that stuff. But as far as the Earth at large goes, humans have been incredibly terrible for the Earth's preservation.
There's a name for it now. Anthropocene extinction event. Because if you look at kind of like the history of the planet, there have been so far, there are mass extinctions like all the time where like, you know, tons and tons of species die off, even upwards of like 75% to 90% of all species on the planet all die off at once, not like at once, but within a few thousands of years. So like there's something called the background extinction rate, where like on a typical normal Earth period of time, you'd expect some species to just naturally go extinct. Like, that's just going to happen. That's just how evolution works. But there will be periods of time in like geologic history where there will be a spike, and suddenly you'll see tons of species die off really close to each other. So that's like a mass extinction. There have been 5 mass extinction events, the most recent of which was the one where the dinosaurs died off. Basically, that was about like 66 million years ago. But there have been a bunch before that that were even worse. So like the worst one, I want to say, was the Permian extinction, where like over 90% of all life on Earth died off. And that was just from like, you know, volcanic activity and like some kind of natural Earth stuff going on. But like, you see these mass extinctions pop up every once in a while. And it is really difficult now to like determine, because that's all easy to measure in retrospect, right? Because you can see how things were before and how things were after and like measure like the trend. But now it's on like researchers currently to try to judge what is currently happening on the planet. And like you mentioned earlier, that is really hard to tell. Like, it is hard to get numbers on a lot of this stuff. So, but there's a lot of evidence that kind of shows you like we're in one of those mass extinctions. Like, we are in one of those spikes. We don't know how high it's going to get. We don't know how it's going to measure up to the other spikes. But it's happening. Like, we can already see that. Like, if you look at the line graph of like extinction rates, we can already see it going up, like even now.
No, it's fascinating. And there's, for all this that we do know, there's so much we don't know. There's more that we don't know. And so it's interesting to think like what the animal and human kingdoms will look like historically 100, 1,000, 1 million, 1 years from now.
I've seen some like discussion around like which animals are thriving and which animals are not thriving, you know, like now in our current sort of like ecological situation. Insects not doing so good. Insects are suffering a lot. Amphibians not doing good at all. And things are not going well for amphibians.
Well, that's probably because my son won't stop catching them in the pond and putting them in
He's ground zero. He's suspect number one. Get his
ass. Sorry, go ahead. Yeah, well, I mean, honestly, I'd be okay with it because, yeah, I'm sick of seeing frogs die in their little habitat.
But there are like some animals that are projected to actually thrive in the conditions that like is kind of being caused by the changing climate of the world. So like jellyfish are one that like jellyfish are going to do amazing. Like
I was just telling somebody the other day, I wish there were more jellyfish around because I love seeing jellyfish washed up on the beach.
Did you maybe wish it was all jellyfish? That's kind of... We're heading into a real jellyfish era. It's real jellyfish hours coming up.
Let me go back through this top 10 list real quick. So we had number 10, goats, with 850 million goats in the world. Number 9 was dogs. Number 8, sheeps. Number 7, pig. Number 6, cattle. Number 5, humans at 8 billion. Number 4, bats. Number 3, birds. There's 50 billion birds. Number 2 is fish with 3.5 trillion, and strong, healthy number 1 lead with 10 quintillion, or 1.4 billion for every one human, is insects.
I like how for insects, it's not even in the same like realm of as the other ones. Like it's not even vaguely close.
No, I know. Well, it's like
by orders of magnitude.
Yeah. Okay. Ellen, what'd you think of this list? Are you happy you were here, or did you hate it?
I had fun. I had fun dragging you down with me. I took a lot of L's.
I'm glad one of us had fun. Kidding, of course. This was a blast. I'm so glad you were here with me to talk about animals, but I can't let you go without telling the listeners how to hear more about animals on your podcast, Just the Zoo of Us.
Absolutely. For sure. So I am the host of Just the Zoo of Us. We have two different types of episodes. We have co-hosted episodes where my husband and I each review an animal by rating them out of 10 in different categories. And when we're not doing that, we do guested episodes where I bring on guests who, like I mentioned earlier, you know, study snailfish in the hadal zone of the ocean or, you know, have studied wildlife in Africa or, you know, all over the planet. We get really cool guests on to come and talk about the animals that they study, and we have a really good time talking to them. That's called Just the Zoo of Us. It is also family friendly. So for anybody who listens with kids, you listen with a family, you know, it is PG rated. So feel free to...
Just like our show.
I hope not. Unless your kids are super cool. If you got really
Tennis
cool
podcast
kids.
Is fucking PG all the way, man. Seriously.
It's PG as fuck.
Yes.
So and that's
I'm
all,
sorry, I cut you off.
No worries, you're good. I cut myself off. That is on the Maximum Fun Network, so you can find us over at MaximumFun.org or wherever you get podcasts.
Yes, and I will put a link to the show notes for the listeners to find easy access to Just the Zoo of Us. I just listened to it today, the episode on the bell spider and the oarfish. I gotta say, I disagree with some of those ratings, but...
a little harsh.
You were.
I was a little mean.
I feel bad for that oarfish.
I was bringing the heat. That I don't know, I was in a mood.
But really educational, fun episode. A lot like today's episode that we just did with the fun facts about these different animals. It's like that, but honing in on one or two specific animals. I think you'll like it a lot, and I hope you'll check it out. Just the Zoo of Us.
Thank you so much. And of course, it's always a blast talking to you. So I really appreciate you having me here, and I had a lot of fun.
Yeah, and I hope you'll come on again. Hopefully it won't be 2 years later.
In
like
90
this
episodes.
Time. Oh, that's right. I forgot we had the 90 episode quota. Okay, so for episode 359. Mm-hmm. We will see Ellen back in the year 2026. Until then, I choose to believe that the chicken is the closest relative to the Tyrannosaurus Rex. And any final words from you, Ellen?
Yeah, fuck ants.
Whoa! Okay, I'm editing that out. No way. Ants rule.
I'll go ahead and get that in there so that they know where to go. you heard it here on the Tennis podcast when the uprising comes.
No, ants. Ants are very cool. Not
just,
we don't
just
fuck
kidding, ants. I love you.
No. Ellen, thanks so much. Listeners, thanks so much. And I'll see you next time.